One of the most frequently commented upon issues of e-bikes is the cost involved. So today, let's have a look at some of the alternative ways of converting your mountain bike to an e-bike by way of aftermarket mid-drive motors. Now, the bikes we ride here at EMBN are incredibly sophisticated systems. The fully integrated motor, battery, and chassis have been created not just out of the best design and best materials, they're very efficient, and they also use the best e-bike geometry, finishing, and componentry. Like I said, they're very much a system rather than a collection of parts, and they're also very dynamic in the way the power is transferred via torque sensors. However, the bikes we ride don't actually come cheap, but there are alternative ways to avoid that significant cost involved in buying that mountain bike, and that is by converting your existing mountain bike to an e-bike by way of these retrofit mid-drive motors which I mentioned earlier. So what do they look like? Here is a Paradox unit. This comes from Greece. As you can see, it's pretty dinky, it's pretty small. Behind me I've got a selection of others. This is a Bafang motor which is bolted to a downhill bike, and we'll talk about how that power is transferred there later. And over here is a Lift MTB motor, which comes from France. That's a little company in northern France there. And as you can see, controls and the leads which power that. Now, one of the first things you need to be aware of with these retrofit kits is they're not all pedal assist. A lot of them are actually throttle operated, which means they're not limited in the speeds that they can do. However, there are some kits, such as the Bafang, which you can switch between throttle assist and pedal assist. So that's quite a neat system, but I'll go into that a little bit later on. So why are we talking about mid-drive motors, not hub drives? Well, there's lots of excellent hub drives out there, both front and rear wheel drive, and they come in a vast array of power outputs. And when it comes to pedaling fire roads or smooth single track or commuting, they're very, very good at doing that job. However, the strength of a mid-drive motor is that the power to the rear wheel is controlled by the same gears, chain, and through the pedals, which means the ratios are far more suited to off-road use than the hub drive, which has got just a single gear ratio, which means that on the steeper hill climbs they're not quite as good as that hub, that mid-drive with that range of gears. The other thing with the hub drive is that because all the weight is located in the middle of that wheel, all the impacts are going to go through the rider, whereas the mid-drive unit is centrally placed, which means the weight is that not only is there a low center of gravity, but the weight is distributed more evenly so that there's a good balance of the whole chassis and the rider on the bike. Yes, so how much do they cost? That's a big question. Now, for say a 250 watt motor, which is quite a low powered motor, about £500, but remember you've got the cost of the battery to go on top of that. Plus, remember, there's the cost of your bike. Now, as you go up in power, they do become quite expensive. So you can spend about 3,000 euros for a really powerful motor. But remember, the more powerful the motor, the more weight equals less range. But they still are a really good option for many people as a starter, because you can buy, say, a hardtail, a new or a second-hand hardtail for about £600. By the time you fit an aftermarket kit, you've got a dream bike for about £1,600. On the other hand, you could choose like my mate has done, and he has bought a second-hand downhill bike. This cost him £900 off eBay, which is an incredible set of forks, a great chassis. And he's bought his Bafang motor from China, that was £200, and he's got some batteries which he's bought himself with his own battery management system. So you're looking at £1,500 for a complete bike there, and it's a really, really good uplift option. What though if you want to have a new bike? What if you want to have a new bike with a custom kit? Well, there's lots of good bikes out there which you can buy, such as the Vita Somet, £1,700. And you know, by the time you've bolted a kit on, that takes the price up to £2,700. And I'm thinking, well, there's some really good custom e-bikes such as the High Bike or the Canyon Spectral on the market for £2,900. But I think if you've got £600 and you want to convert your existing mountain bike, then I think a mid-drive kit is a good way to go. fitting? Yes, that is obviously a crucial question, and the answer is yes and no. It all depends on the motor you're using and the type of battery you're going to have with that motor. It also depends on whether you're going to be using a hardtail or a full suspension mountain bike. But the detail involved here is a lot of these aftermarket motors are mounted through the bottom bracket, and you do have to have a 68 to 73 bottom bracket for these motors to fit. Yes, where does the battery go? Well, if you've got a hardtail, you're very lucky, that can be bolted onto the inside of the down tube, and it's actually quite a neat system. However, if you've got a full suspension bike, most of the time you're going to be carrying the battery round in a backpack, and they vary in weight from brand to brand, but you're looking at 3 kilos. However, my mate here has got his system, and he carries his battery in his backpack. This is one of his packs, that is about 6 miles, but he usually carries about 3 of those on a big ride. In the battery goes, you zip her up. So I'm not really very experienced at this, but I do know that you put your backpack on. Obviously you've got your helmet on. So then the power lead connects to this power lead. So there you go. And the bike is actually now ready to go. It's got pedal assist, remember, on this Bafang motor, and also throttle assist. So I'm thinking that if I press that throttle, oh my god! Off you go. So I think you can see I've given a demonstration there of how these bikes work. You can actually configure how much output comes from the motor by way of software. Now Spoon's bike here, he's got a system where it's 20% pedal assist and 50% throttle assist. So if you're pedaling up the hill in pedal assist and you want to turn, you just simply go to throttle, which is 50%, that overrides your pedal assist, so you might as well not pedal. And if you want to change that, well, you can do that back at home, unless you've got a display on the bike here. This system over here, the Lift MTB, as you can see, it's got a really neat display on the handlebar, together with your throttle, with the amount of battery on there. And yeah, you can control the amount of output through the motor simply by changing that on the handlebar. Yes, weight is really important, and don't expect to see many of these aftermarket motors coming in under the 3 kilo mark. And remember, the more power, the more weight, and you know, the less range, etc., etc. However, this motor here, which this beautifully made Paradox Hermes from Greece, look at it, it's so dinky, it's so well made. That comes in, remember, there's all the parts as well, the chain wheel there, and the leads, and the fitting, comes in about 2.6 kilos. So how does it compare to, say, a Shimano or a Brose or a Bosch? Well, this is the very latest Brose motor, Brose Mag S. Bear with me, because there's actually a cover on there, which means it's, you know, the motor is actually a lot smaller than that. And that comes in about 2.5 kilos. Now, when it comes to the weight and the power output and the torque of each of these aftermarket motors, later on in this video, I'm going to be going through some of the figures of each of these systems. I think it all comes down to the amount of power you put through that transmission. If you've got a very powerful motor, that's obviously going to chew up your transmission. You're also going to be very careful with the chain line. Now, some mid-drive aftermarket bikes haven't got a very good chain line, which is obviously going to put a lot of stress on your chain and gears. When it comes to waterproofness, you need to be very careful in the fine print of some of these motors. Some of them say they're waterproof, some of them water resistant, but again, it comes down to where you use them, how you use them, and how much power is on each of the motor. Yeah, so this is where it probably gets a little bit messy. Now, as I mentioned earlier, a lot of the aftermarket mid-drive bikes are 250 to 500 watts. There are ones which are more, 750, 1500. As I mentioned, at that point, they do tend to cook the transmission on the bike. But not only that, you need to be careful with the battery involved with the bike. Now, you need to be very careful. Now, Spoons here, who's got this bike, has got lithium polymer battery and with the battery management system. Now, you need to be extremely, extremely careful when it comes to batteries on these aftermarket mid-drives, because you really need to know what you're doing and be aware of the dangers involved in charging and mixing and matching these batteries. Now, when it comes to things such as the fitting, now, as you can see, this Lift MTB motor here has got a pretty good ground clearance. This is where the ground clearance would normally be between the bottom of the chainring and the floor. Obviously, it's neatly tucked out the way there. Obviously, this depends on what frame design you've got. What you're trying to avoid is having something that's low down, so it's going to be catching the floor. Now, on the other hand, Spoons' bike over here has got probably one of the neatest bolt-on kits I've seen on a bike. But still, you can see that that motor is significantly lower than the chain line, which is going to come into contact with, you know, rocks and roots on the trail. At the same time, you need to put this all into context. Obviously, the bottom bracket height in the first place is really important. I can see that the bottom bracket height on this 224 is actually quite high. I'm guessing it's in the kind of 360, 370 area. So relative to maybe the bikes that we ride, about 350mm on the bottom bracket, then, you know, it's actually probably all right. Yeah, you need to ask yourself, do you actually need more power on your e-bike? Now, there's a fantastic quote by Mattia, who owns Lift MTB in France, who make these aftermarket motors. He actually got an incredible website. He's got all the answers when it comes to aftermarket mid-drive bikes. Just check that out. But his quote, he says that the race to more power is an endless quest, and you'll never have enough power to use the engine as a motorcycle. You'll have either a very heavy motorized bicycle or a really underpowered motorcycle. In short, one between the two is no fun at all. Says it all. Right, let's have a look then at what aftermarket kits are available to bolt onto your bike. Starting off with the Bafang. The aftermarket kits come in the BBS-01, the BBS-02, which is fitted to Spoons' bike over there, and the BBS-HD. Now, when it comes to the power outputs, they are from 250 up to 1,000 watt motors, and the torque from 80 newton meters up to 160 newton meters on the top end motor. As I mentioned earlier, they're both pedal assist and throttle assist. And the weight of the motor from 4.8 to 5.2 kilograms. They're not light, but as I said, they give you that pedal assist, which is a really good option. And yeah, definitely one to check out. Now, the prices on the Bafang start around £600. At the same time, this is the French-made Lift MTB. Now, these start at about €999. So when it comes to the power outputs of the Lift MTB, remember this is a throttle-only unit. The watts is 450 watts nominal to 750 watts max. Newton meters is 80 to 90 newton meters at the rear wheel. It's a pretty light system, 3.2 kilograms. Obviously, there's the weight of the battery to go with that. And the good thing about Lift MTB, it's got a vast range of batteries ranging from about 1.1 kilos up to 2.9 kilos. Which brings us to the Paradox Hermes, the Greek-made beautiful unit. €3,000 for this system. But I can tell you, it is a very, very well-made unit. This too is a throttle-only system. It's 1,200 watts nominal and 130 newton meters of torque. The battery is 744 watt hours. So that is actually pretty similar. It's actually a bit more than the one on the new Specialized Turbo Levo. And that goes into a backpack. And I think Alex at Paradox has got his own backpacks to go with that. And finally, the Ego Kit. Now, the Ego Kit is the one that Martin Ashton used when he rode down the World Cup track in Fort William, and also when he went out to Whistler, on which was custom fitted to his Canyon Sender. Now, when it comes to the Ego Kits, there's two kits available. They are 2,400 watts and 3,400 watts. Now, I'm just thinking, oh my God, that is just like massive. When you think that, you know, the bikes that we ride, this Specialized Turbo Evo is 250 watt nominal. Now you look at the prices, €2,999 or €3,999. The weight of the motor is 3.2 kilograms, but it's 5.5 kilograms on the bike. So that's a significant amount of weight. The weight of the battery, 5.9 kilograms. So there's a huge weight involved. Like I mentioned earlier, when you've got more power, there's more weight, which means there's more drain on that battery. So there you go. I think I've covered most things in simple terms. Obviously, there's lots of detail and lots of other e-bike motors on the market. I'm sure there will be comments below which reminded me about these. But as I said, this is like a basic overview of aftermarket e-bike motors. But please let us know your comments below so we can get this conversation going about these retro kits. If you want to see more about e-bike motors, the custom e-bike motors which we use here on EMBN, check out this video here. And don't forget, you can like, share and subscribe to EMBN to make sure we can keep these in-depth videos coming. Thanks very much.